Hello. Today we're going to speak about one of the most interesting periods in English history, about the 16th century. That was the age of great geographical discoveries, of Reformation, and, what is most important, the age of the Renaissance. The 16th century, also known as the Tudor Age, was a highly remarkable period in English history. The first Tudor king, Henry VII, established absolute monarchy. His son, Henry VIII, broke away from Rome, bringing in Reformation. And Henry VIII's daughter, Elizabeth I, brought glory to the country, defeating Spain and promoting the spread of Renaissance in England. I've already said that that was the age of the great geographical discoveries and the beginning of colonization of America. 7 years after the end of the Wars of the Roses, Columbus reached the West Indies. And 6 years later, his exploit was followed by Vasco da Gama, who made a voyage to the Cape of Good Hope. These events were the climax of a long series of changes transforming the relations between Europe and the East and the beginning of European contacts with the American continent. The old trade routes between Europe and Asia were not only long, they implied transshipment of goods. All goods were passed on from merchant to merchant along the route, and each merchant took a substantial profit. The sea voyages were purely coastal because ships were primitive, basin-shaped vessels. The high cost of transportation of goods made it unprofitable to carry bulky merchandise. The imported goods were mainly objects of luxury. And yet, trade with the East, which was in the hands of small groups of merchants and towns, like the Hanseatic towns, flourished. But each route was a jealously guarded monopoly, and the so-called owners of the routes guarded them even by armed force. The 15th century saw great changes in the technique of shipbuilding and navigation. Spain and Portugal developed the caravel for coastal trade in the Atlantic. The compass, which had been known since the 12th century, was perfected. This is a compass which belonged to Sir Francis Drake. And when Vasco da Gama returned to Lisbon from India with a cargo which repaid 60-fold the cost of his voyage, the effect was shattering, and overseas voyages followed in a quick succession. The newly discovered American continent proved to be rich in gold and silver beyond any dreams. And as it was impossible to keep the precious metals within Spain and Portugal, they spread all over Europe, stimulating the development of commerce of Spain's rivals. And the most important rivals of Spain were France, Holland, and England. England was not strong enough to challenge Spain and Portugal in the Spanish Main, and she was forced to look for ways of her own. In 1497, John Cabot, a Venetian sailor in the English Bay, discovered Newfoundland and sailed along part of the North American coast. Then England turned her attention to the northeast, and in 1551, Richard Chancellor, Sebastian Cabot, and Sir Hugh Willoughby decided to look for the northeast passage to China. The first expedition of the company of merchant adventurers departed from London on the 10th of May, 1553. When the ships were caught in a storm, Chancellor's ship was separated from the other two, and the crews of the other two ships perished in the ice. But Chancellor himself managed to reach the city of Archangel and establish trade relations with Muscovy. The region had just recently been added to Muscovy, and when Tsar Ivan the Terrible, or Ivan the Fourth, heard of Chancellor's arrival, he immediately invited the exotic guest to visit Moscow for an audience at the royal court. The Russian Tsar was pleased to open the sea trading routes with England and other countries. Chancellor was no less optimistic, finding a good market for his English wool and receiving furs and other Russian continental goods in return. When he returned to England in 1554, he had letters from the Tsar inviting British traders and promising trade privileges. The Company of Merchant Adventurers renamed itself the Muscovy Company. It began to serve as an important diplomatic link between Muscovy and England. Have a look at the map again. In 1557, the first Russian ambassador, Osip Nepeya, reached London. The English could not forgive King Henry VII, who had refused to support Columbus. But Henry VII, founder of the Tudor dynasty, was preoccupied with other things. He felt that he had to restore the English crown to its former position. The Wars of the Roses had undermined agriculture, trade, and industry. But what is more, they had undermined confidence in monarchy as an institution. The king was seen as unable or unwilling to protect the rights of all his subjects. The royal government was manipulated by individuals who fell in and out of favor. Thus, the king had to restore his right not only to reign, but to rule. Henry VII firmly believed that wars damaged the development of trade. And remembering the lessons of the Civil War, he forbade any nobleman to keep armed men. At the same time, the king built a regular army that obeyed only himself. Henry strengthened England's prestige and wealth by 6 commercial treaties that restored England's position in the European market. Realizing that England's future depended on international trade, Henry VII freely spent money on building ships for a merchant fleet. Henry VII made peace with France. In order to avoid military conflicts with Spain and Scotland, he married his eldest sons Arthur and, after his death, Henry, to the Spanish princess Catherine of Aragon, and his daughter Margaret was married to King James IV of Scotland. It was also during his reign that England started pursuing its famous policy of divide and rule. England prevented any country of Europe from becoming overwhelmingly strong, promising its support first to one party and then the other. Henry VII was known for the efficiency of his financial and administrative policies. He introduced new methods of government. He concentrated all power in his hands. The ministers were personally selected by the king for their ability, shrewdness, and loyalty. The king was preoccupied with utmost economy. In a relatively short period of time, he managed to establish a system of checks, the record of which never left his hands. He personally looked through all the record books and signed every single page. When Henry VII died in 1509, he left about £2 million. That was a vast sum, equal to at least 15 years' ordinary revenue at the time. Henry VII is known as founder of an absolute monarchy in England. His son, Henry VIII, waged costly wars on the continent and in Scotland. He centralized administrative authority and made use of Parliament's powers. He patronized the arts and astronomy. He was well read in theology, and at the same time, he was pleasure seeking and wasteful with money. He spent so much on maintaining a magnificent court and on wars that his father's money was soon gone. Gold and silver from America added to the economic inflation. In order to raise more money, Henry ordered to reduce the amount of silver used in coins. And although that step resulted in immediate profit, it led to a dramatic rise in prices. Within 25 years, the English coinage was reduced to a seventh of its value. Although Henry VIII's father had become powerful by taking over his nobles' lands, the lands owned by monasteries and abbeys remained untouched. The church was a huge and powerful landowner. Since it was controlled from Rome, it was an international organization, almost a trust, with Spain and France struggling for control over papacy. For one thing, the Catholic Church could work against the king's authority. For another, taxes paid to the church reduced the king's income. At the same time, the church was losing respect and popularity with the population, as the clergy often failed to perform church services, but lived in wealth, comfort, and sin. An important thing that happened in the 16th century was the Reformation in England. That event split Europe, opposing to each other blocks of Protestant and Catholic countries. England was steadily involved in the conflict with powerful Catholic powers. But the European ideas of Reformation proclaimed by Martin Luther in Germany and by John Calvin in Geneva were not very popular in England, although the English humanists demanded reform of the church, but from within. In 1521, King Henry VIII got the title of Defender of the Faith from the Pope of Rome for his best-selling book, criticizing Luther's teaching. But a break with Rome became a political necessity 5 years later. In 1526, Henry VIII decided to obtain a divorce from his wife, Catherine of Aragon, or, strictly speaking, a papal declaration that his marriage was invalid since Catherine had been previously married to his elder brother. One of the real reasons for the divorce was the fact that Catherine could not provide a male heir and secure the future of the Tudor dynasty. Their only surviving child was Princess Mary, the future queen, Mary Tudor, or Mary I. Another reason was that Henry was planning an alliance with France against Spain, and Catherine was a Spanish princess. There would have been no problem for Henry with the Pope if Rome had not just been taken by Catherine's nephew, King Charles V of Spain. For political and family reasons, the King of Spain objected to the divorce, and Pope Clement did not want to anger either Charles V or Henry VIII. When he finally forbade the divorce, Henry broke away from Rome by the Act of Supremacy, which was voted for by Parliament in 1534. The Act of Supremacy declared that the King of England was supreme head of the Church of England. and through several acts of parliament, England became politically a Protestant country, even though the popular religion was still Catholic. Henry VIII established the Protestant Reformation in England by creating the Church of England with a monarch as the supreme head. When the church was brought under the control of the state, the king took the English Reformation further. He ordered to have a careful survey of all church property. That was the first properly organized tax survey since the time of the Domesday Book, actually since the 11th century. Henry VIII closed down 823 monasteries and confiscated their property. As church lands and property were sold to the rising classes of merchants and landowners, King Henry's policy made him popular with them. Monastery buildings were either neglected or destroyed, and the stone was used as building material. The suppression of monasteries was the greatest act of official destruction in British history. Now the church was brought under the control of the state. As for Henry VIII, he could now marry Anne Boleyn, the mother of future Queen Elizabeth I. Well, these are Henry VIII's six wives: Catherine of Aragon, Anne Boleyn. Unfortunately, Anne gave birth to a baby daughter, Princess Elizabeth, and she produced no male heir, and she was beheaded in 1536. And King Henry married Jane Seymour, who died in 1537, leaving him a son. Henry's next wife was Anne of Cleves, but that marriage was later annulled. Henry's fifth wife, Catherine Howard, was executed for adultery in 1542. His last marriage was to Catherine Parr in 1543. Catherine Parr survived him and died in 1548, a year after his death. A popular rhyme about Henry VIII's wives goes as follows: divorced, beheaded, died; divorced, beheaded, survived. Henry VIII's reign was remarkable in many ways. He established the Protestant Reformation in England by creating the Church of England with the monarch as the supreme head. He suppressed England's 823 monasteries. He centralized administrative authority, and he incorporated Wales into England. Henry also built a modern Royal Navy and got the nickname Father of the English Navy. Upon his death, he left a modern fleet of 53 warships. He died of leg ulcer, which made his last years a misery. Henry VIII's son Edward, who came to the throne at the age of 9, reigned only 6 years and died of tuberculosis. After the unsuccessful attempt to shift the royal succession of the Tudor dynasty to the Dudley family, the crown went to Mary Tudor, also known as Bloody Mary. Mary Tudor was the only surviving child of Henry VIII and Catherine of Aragon, and she was a devout Catholic. She re-established Roman Catholicism as the nation's only creed. She burned 283 Protestant martyrs. That's why she was called Bloody Mary. She joined Spain in a war against France and lost the remaining English possession on the continent, the port of Calais, in 1558. Upon her death, the throne went to her half-sister Elizabeth, the daughter of Henry VIII and Anne Boleyn. But before we speak about the Elizabethan age and Elizabeth herself, let us speak about the first period of the Renaissance. Because together with the ideas of the Reformation came the ideas of the Renaissance. Emerging from feudal despotism, the Renaissance in Europe developed all that was original in the medieval ideas by the light of antique arts and literature. The literature and the fine arts of the Renaissance were notable for their glorification of man and the discovery of his virtues. The names of Dante, Petrarch, Boccaccio, Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo in Italy, Rabelais in France, Erasmus in the Netherlands, Copernicus in Poland, Thomas More, Francis Bacon and Shakespeare in England make the treasure trove of world cultural heritage. The greatest geographical discoveries evoked a lively interest in nature, history and life in other countries. There was hardly any man of importance at the time who had not travelled extensively, who did not speak four or five languages, who did not shine in a number of fields. Albrecht Dürer, for example, was a painter, an engraver, a sculptor and an architect. Leonardo da Vinci was a painter, a mathematician and an engineer. Machiavelli was a statesman, a historian, a poet, and the first notable military author of his time. The wave of the Renaissance reached the shores of England only in the 16th century. Foreign scholars and artists appeared in England during the reign of Henry VIII. In painting and music, the first period of the Renaissance was that of imitation. Painting was represented by the German artist Holbein, and music by Italians and by French musicians. With literature, though, the situation was different. The freedom of thought of English humanists revealed itself in anti-feudal and even anti-bourgeois ideas, showing the life of their own people as it really was, and all that was reflected in literature. The most prominent figure of the first period of the Renaissance was Thomas More. He was the first English humanist of the Renaissance. More was the son of a prominent judge. He was educated at Oxford and could write a most beautiful Latin and Greek. On his return from Oxford to London in 1494, More continued to study law at Lincoln's Inn, and in 1501 he became barrister. While he was at Lincoln's Inn, More decided to dedicate himself to monastic service. It was only his sense of duty and responsibility that made him serve the country in the field of politics. In 1499, Thomas More made friends with Erasmus of Rotterdam, who spent a number of years in England teaching at Oxford and Cambridge, and Erasmus greatly influenced the ideas of English scholars and philosophers. Their acquaintance turned into a lasting friendship and correspondence. When Erasmus wrote his famous work, Praise of Folly, in 1509, he dedicated it to Thomas More. During the reign of Henry VII, Thomas More became Member of Parliament, and later he was made Speaker of the House of Commons in 1523. As Speaker, he helped to establish the parliamentary privilege of free speech. One of his first acts as a member of parliament was to urge a decrease in a proposed appropriation for Henry VII. Although our Tudor monarchy was absolute and parliament had little power to resist the king, there was one privilege which parliament enjoyed: to grant money to the monarch. And when Henry VII wanted Parliament to grant him £800,000 for 1 year, members of Parliament sat silent until Thomas More stood up and urged that the request should be refused. After a long discussion, a sum less than half the amount originally requested was granted, and that sum was to be spread over a period of 4 years. In revenge, the king imprisoned More's father, and his father was released only after the king's death in 1509. During the next decade, More attracted the attention of Henry VIII. He accompanied the king on his visit to Flanders. He was made member of the Privy Council, and he was finally knighted in 1521. In 1529, Thomas More was made Lord Chancellor, that is, the presiding officer in the House of Lords and the highest judge. Thomas More was an earnest Catholic. He even helped Henry VIII in writing his theological essays. But when Henry VIII broke with Rome, Thomas More refused to swear allegiance to him as the head of the Church of England. Neither could he recognize the legitimacy of Henry's marriage to Anne Boleyn. And soon Thomas More fell victim to the king's anger. He was accused of treason, and he was thrown into the Tower and finally beheaded in 1535. You can look at the bell tower where he was kept prisoner. More's last words were, "The king's good servant, but God's first." Thomas More was canonized in 1935. Thomas More wrote both in Latin and in English. His English writings include discussions on political subjects, biographies, and even poetry. The work by which he is remembered today is Utopia, which was written in Latin in 1516. By now, it has been translated into all European languages. Utopia, which in Greek means nowhere, is the name of a non-existing island. The work is divided into two books. In the first book, the writer gives a profound and truthful picture of the people's sufferings and shows the social evils existing in England. And in the second book, More presents his idea of what the future society should be like. Utopia has become a byword to denote an unattainable ideal, usually in social or political matters. Utopia was the first book to proclaim the ideas of communism. It was highly esteemed by all the humanists of Europe in More's time and grew popular again in the 19th century. The most significant period of the Renaissance falls on the reign of Queen Elizabeth, the daughter of Henry VIII and Anne Boleyn. Upon her mother's execution, she fell out of favor and was allowed to appear at court only when Henry VIII married Catherine Parr. During the reign of her half-sister Mary I, Elizabeth was imprisoned in the Tower of London, and when she came to the throne in 1558, she faced the problems of religious strife, unstable finance, a war with France, and tense relations with Scotland. She ended the war with France, she re-established the Church of England, she imprisoned her rival, Mary, Queen of Scots, and in 1587 executed her for treason. Elizabeth was a strong and cautious ruler who set her enemies against one another in order to strengthen the position of England. During her reign, England established itself as a major European power in politics, commerce, and the arts. Her reign is considered by many as the golden age of English history, which produced not only a gallery of authors of genius, some of whom have never been surpassed, but also prosperity for the entire nation. Merchants formed the East India Company in 1600. Francis Drake, Walter Raleigh, and other daring English adventurers explored the West Indies and the coasts of North and South America. The English explored and colonized distant lands, and wealth from the colonies poured into England. For different reasons, Elizabeth never got married and came to be known in history as the Virgin Queen. Long before her death, she had transformed herself into a powerful image of female authority, regal magnificence, and national pride. She portrayed the image of herself as the humble wife to her superior husband, England, and as a servant of the people. Through controlling access to herself, Elizabeth had built her success on her ability to divide and conquer. England's success in commerce brought prosperity to the nation, as I've already said, and gave a chance to many people of talent to develop their abilities. Explorers, men of letters, philosophers, poets, and famous dramatists appeared in a quick succession. The great men of the so-called Elizabethan age distinguished themselves in many fields and displayed a thirst for knowledge. They were often called the Elizabethans. Among the favorites of the Queen was the celebrated traveler Sir Walter Raleigh, who wrote poetry and history. Sir Walter organized expeditions to colonize North America. It was Walter Raleigh who introduced tobacco and potatoes to England. He also founded a colony on the American coast, which he called Virginia, in honor of Elizabeth, the Virgin Queen. In 1595, he led an unsuccessful expedition to the Orinoco River, that is, the present-day Venezuela. So he led that expedition in search of gold. Later, during the reign of James I, he fell out of favor and was imprisoned in the Tower. There, he wrote his famous History of the World. After the failure of his second expedition to the Orinoco in 1617, he was executed. And now the town of Raleigh is the capital of North Carolina in the United States of America. The Queen also favored the famous pirate, Her Majesty's Admiral, Sir Francis Drake. He was the most famous seaman of the Elizabethan age. He was a navigator, a pirate, one of the greatest English sea captains in history. Drake made several slave trading expeditions to West Africa and the Spanish Main. In 1577, from 1577 to 1580, he circumnavigated the globe on board the Golden Hind.
In the first half of the 16th century, England had been weakened by years of tyranny and religious persecution. As a seafaring nation, it came to be overshadowed and threatened by the already mighty Empire of Spain. Despite this, there were still Englishmen who looked outwards, across the waters, awaiting their chance to rise up and lead their nation against the tide of history. They were a new breed whose moment was about to come. And first, forever, among them was Sir Francis Drake. Thank you. suffered a period of civil and religious unrest under first Edward and then, more damagingly, Mary, whose ambition it was to save England from Protestantism by handing it over to the Spanish king. English seafaring expeditions suffered badly from her disinterest. Even John Cabot, whose voyages had provided grounds for an English claim to North America, was ignored. When, instead, the French capitalized on Cabot's discoveries, his son Sebastian left England in disgust to serve Spain, which had already financed Magellan's circumnavigation of the globe. Into this miserable period, somewhere between 1540 and 1545, Francis Drake was born on a farm in Crowndale near the Devon town of Tavistock. He was one of 12 children. This was the time of the Marian persecutions, and in 1549, his father Edmund, a Protestant, was driven out of the county by a Catholic mob and fled to Gillingham in Kent. Drake remained all his life a devout Protestant who detested Catholicism. It was an attitude which would play no small part in shaping both his own destiny and that of England. When Queen Elizabeth came to the throne in 1558, a period of calm and stability began. England was still a weak power, but a recovery began to take place. While avoiding open conflict with Spain, the Queen turned a blind eye to private incursions against the Spanish king. In this way, she created an atmosphere in which men like Drake were turned into practiced and expert seamen by becoming privateers. Thus, the old English tradition of piracy, which lay at the heart of England's struggle to assert itself, was harnessed by the crown.
Yes, English piracy in the Channel had been known ever since the 15th century. And during the Elizabethan age, preying on Spanish and Portuguese ships became almost a national pastime. The Queen and the government adapted themselves to the new existing circumstances. Where the interests of the nation were concerned, they relied on able men of all classes. Walter Raleigh, Admiral Cecil, and Francis Drake were the typical new men of the Tudor making. Finally, Spain was provoked into a naval war. The Spanish fleet, called the Invincible Armada, had never been defeated before. But Spanish ships were not built for sea battles, while the English vessels were capable of maneuvering and fighting under sail. For Francis Drake, the ship was a fighting unit. And in 1588, the Queen's 30 ships, led by Francis Drake, defeated the enemy fleet, and a terrible storm destroyed what was left of it. This portrait of Elizabeth I is known as the Armada portrait, with the Invincible Armada in full sail in the background and the defeated Armada in the right-hand corner. The defeat of the Armada was announced in the first newspaper printed in England specially for the occasion. The idea was then forgotten and revived only 50 years later. During Elizabeth's reign, England experienced the true cultural reawakening of thought and arts. Elizabeth's court was a magnet which attracted the most talented individuals of the era. Music, poetry, literature, and drama flourished under Elizabeth's reign, largely due to the Queen's love of the arts. The Queen's tastes set the standards for the aristocracy and the rest of the society. they fostered an atmosphere in which many of England's greatest writers found encouragement and even financial support. A newly rich merchant class, as well as the nobility, wanted entertainment and fine arts, and thus they were willing to pay for them. Writers, painters, musicians flocked to London and turned it into a European cultural center. Elizabeth's court became a center for poets, musicians, and scholars. Elizabethan architecture changed the medieval styles of earlier times, bringing out the beauty of the Renaissance. The most famous architect of the period, Inigo Jones, was famous for building Banqueting House of Whitehall in London. The Elizabethans created an elaborate system of activities and events to keep themselves entertained. A major part of the Elizabethan lifestyle was connected with entertainments, feasts and festivals, games and other entertainments. From the beginning to the end of each year, Elizabethans found ways to keep themselves amused. They pursued leisure activities with great passion. Every season of the year had special days that drew the people together to celebrate. One of the greater festivals of the year was held at Easter time. The May Day celebration meant decorating the Maypole and dancing around it. In summer, bonfires were burnt and dances were held to celebrate Midsummer's Eve on the 24th of June. Winter holidays began at Christmas and ran through New Year's Eve and ended on the 12th night, that is the 5th of January. Those holidays included gifts, bonfires, music and jollity. Sports played a major role in the leisure time of the Elizabethan age. Some of the indoor games included dice. Let's go back to the previous picture. So some of the indoor games included dice, chess, checkers, and a variety of card games. Some of the outdoor sports and games included golf, horse racing, swimming, fishing, hunting, fencing, and cricket. At that time, a man was supposed to be skilled at tennis, archery, and hunting. While the upper class enjoyed tennis, common people preferred football, but all levels of society enjoyed the sport of hunting. Horses, dogs, and hawks were kept and trained for hunting deer, rabbits, and other wildlife. Elizabeth I herself took pleasure in hunting, bull baiting, and bear baiting. She was fond of hunting parties and dancing. Dancing was a popular activity. The upper class favored courtly dances, while ordinary people were more likely to do traditional country dances. Besides hunting parties and dancing, Queen Elizabeth and her courtiers were fond of music. Musical literacy was expected in the upper class of society and welcome in the lower classes. Many courtiers made their own music. Laborers would sing while they worked, and townspeople would sing or play music after meals. A popular form of entertainment in the countryside was ringing church bells. In the major towns, official musicians gave free public concerts. The wealthy people hired musicians to play during dinner. Music of that period became increasingly expressive and refined, and a knowledge and appreciation of music set apart the truly genteel members of the high social classes. In addition, court musicians gradually moved into their own music houses and guilds. Several different instruments became popular during the Elizabethan era, including the lute, a forerunner of the guitar, the viol, the predecessor to the violin, viola da gamba, the early type of the cello, which you can see in the picture, and the virginal, which was an English modification of the clavichord. In the picture, you can see a musical instrument combining the virginal and the clavichord. The new form of secular music was the madrigal, which originally came from Italy. The first English musician to compose madrigals was William Byrd. He founded one of the strongest and most famous music schools, especially in virginal playing. The Elizabethan era was also a period of great scientific advances. It witnessed great advances in medical science, particularly in the study of human anatomy and surgical operations. Inventions of the period include the graphite pencil, the modern calendar, wind-powered sawmill, and the thermoscope, or a primitive thermometer. In natural history, Sir Francis Bacon completed the break from the medieval scholastic method laid down for the first time the classification of the natural sciences. He prepared the way for modern experimental science. Francis Bacon was a statesman, a philosopher, and an atheist. He made a distinguished parliamentary career under Elizabeth I. As a scholar, he wrote mostly in Latin, as he believed that English would not last and Latin would survive forever. Francis Bacon is also known for his essays, a collection of brief, witty observations on various subjects, reading, education, death, revenge, gardens, and so on. Those essays are admirably clear and simple, and some statements are as memorable as poetry. For example, God Almighty first planted a garden. Revenge is a kind of wild justice. Men fear death as children fear to go in the dark. Francis Bacon's famous phrase, "Knowledge is power," has long become a maxim. According to some critics, it was Francis Bacon who wrote Shakespeare's plays, among other things. Now let us say a few words about the predecessors of Shakespeare. By the middle of the 16th century, education was spreading among the sons of common citizens. The new method of teaching classical literature at universities was through performing Roman plays in Latin. University graduates translated them into English and later started writing plays of their own. They were called the university wits. Among them, there was Christopher Marlowe, Robert Greene, George Peel, Thomas Kean, and others. Some wrote plays for the court, others for public performances. Ancient literature had taught the playwrights to seek new forms and to bring about new progressive ideas. The new drama represented characters and problems topical of the time. Under such favorable circumstances, there came a real upsurge of the drama and poetry. Most plays were written in verse. The second period of the Renaissance in England was characterized by the splendor of its poetry. Highly emotional lyric poetry became widespread. Blank verse and the Italian sonnet were introduced. A sonnet is a poem consisting of 14 lines. The country was often called a nest of singing birds. The Elizabethan age produced a poet whose works were fully appreciated only in the 20th century, who seems to be the product of the atomic age, and yet he lived during the Elizabethan age. John Donne, who lived from 1573 to 1631, started as Jack Donne, a soldier, a lover, a drinker, and a writer of passionate, amorous verses. He ended as Dr. John Donne, Bishop, Dean of St. Paul's, great preacher, and one of the most respected men in the country. And yet, these two extremes coexisted in him all his life. As a passionate lover, he was always analytic and thoughtful, trying to explain his passion almost scientifically. And as a priest, he addressed God with the fierceness of a lover. Donne invented many new verse forms of his own. In his poetry, much reflects his character. Extremes meet, and when his passion is most physical, he expresses it most intellectually. He is always startling and always curiously modern. It is from his poem, For Whom the Bell Tolls, that Ernest Hemingway borrowed the title for his novel. The most acknowledged and prominent poet of the pre-Shakespearean time was Edmund Spenser. He was born in London in 1552. Though his parents descended from a noble house, the family was poor. Spenser's father was a free journeyman for a merchant's company. When Edmund came of age, he went to Cambridge University as a C.S.A.R., that is, a student who paid less for his education than others and had to wait on the welfare students at meal times. Spenser was learned in Hebrew, Greek, Latin, and French. His generation was practically the first to study their mother tongue seriously. While at college, he acted in the tragedies of the ancient masters, and that inspired him to learn and write poetry. Spenser began his literary work at the age of 17. Once a fellow student introduced him to the famous Sir Philip Sidney, who encouraged him to write. Sidney himself was the author of an allegorical romance in prose called Arcadia, which had become very popular as light reading at court. At the age of 23, Spenser took his master's degree. Before returning to London, he lived for a while in the wilderness of Lancashire, where he fell in love, as he himself wrote, with a fair widow's daughter. although his love was not returned, that young lady remained his idol. He clung to his early passion, and that lady became the Rosalind of his poem, The Shepherd's Calendar. Spencer's disappointment in love drove him south, and again he visited Sir Philip Sidney's estate, where he finished writing the poem, which consisted of 12 eclogues. An eclogue is a poem about ideal shepherd's love. The publication of the poem made Spencer one of the most fashionable poets of his day. His poetry was so musical and so colorful that he was often called the poet painter. Spencer was brought to the notice of the Queen. He was given royal favor and was appointed secretary to the new Lord Lieutenant of Ireland. But in Ireland, Spencer felt lonely and forgotten. Nevertheless, he could not help admiring the wild beauty of the place. It was in Ireland that Spencer started writing The Faerie Queen. That was an epic poem describing a 12-day feast honoring the Queen of Fairyland. The poem was addressed to Queen Elizabeth I. It is a combination of the medieval allegory and the Italian romantic epic, of Christian belief and mythology of King Arthur. Spencer imitated antique verse, which was supposed to remind the reader of Chaucer's Canterbury Tales, and Spencer greatly admired the Canterbury Tales. When Spencer presented his simple song, as he called it, to the Queen, the success of the poem was tremendous. The Queen rewarded him with a pension of £50, but his position remained unchanged because poetry was regarded as a noble pastime but not a profession. And Spencer had to go back to Ireland. The end of his life was sorrowful. The suppression of Ireland provoked numerous rebellions against the English, and during one of the rebellions, the castle where he lived was attacked so suddenly and so furiously that Spencer had to flee together with his family, with his wife and children. But his youngest child was burned to death in the blazing castle. Spencer was heartbroken and ruined. He traveled to England in the hope of seeing the Queen, but he died in a London tavern 3 months later before reaching the court. He died in 1599, but he will always be remembered and appreciated for the beauty of his verse. Now let's look at the development of drama. One of the first dramatists of the time was Christopher Marlowe, who lived from 1564 to 1593. Marlowe lived a short life and died at the age of 29. He was born to the family of a shoemaker and was able to go to Canterbury Grammar School when he was 14 years of age. Upon graduating a few years later, he won a scholarship which enabled him to go to Cambridge University. There, he got acquainted with Sir Philip Sidney, the leader of the University Wits. In 1587, Marlowe moved to London. At first, he tried to be an actor, but during a performance at the Curtain Playhouse, he fell off the stage and broke his leg, and that put an end to his acting. And Marlowe took to writing plays. Christopher Marlowe stood above the rest of the university wits. He was the first in English literature to approach history from a political point of view. His principal plays are Dr. Faustus, Tamburlaine, the Duke of Malta, and Edward II. Marlowe's own character revealed itself in the violent passions of his characters. He was fascinated by power. He showed the power of knowledge in Dr. Faustus. In Tamburlaine, one can observe the impact of imperial power. The power of money is the central idea in the Duke of Malta, and the loss of power is shown in Edward II. In the space of 7 years that he wrote for the English stage, Marlowe made a revolution in English playwriting. Like most of the university wits, Marlowe had a wild reputation. He was believed to be an atheist, to keep mistresses, and to be acquainted with thieves. And yet his reputation may have been a clever and deliberate disguise. It is possible that he was a secret agent for the Queen's government. Marlowe died a young man. In 1593, he was stabbed to death in a tavern brawl under very strange circumstances, and his death still remains a mystery. Christopher Marlowe was a great poet and dramatist who might have become as great as William Shakespeare had he not been killed so untimely. The university wits, including Christopher Marlowe, paved the way to William Shakespeare, the greatest of all humanists, who marks the highest point of English Renaissance drama. And we are going to speak about William Shakespeare and the development of the theatre during the Elizabethan period next time. Thank you. Goodbye.